In Morocco, they only speak Arabic or French. When I finally got to the market, I found that they sell chicken with feet on it and really nothing else except for fruit. Here you can see they have signs in French and in Arabic. That's it. Please be able to speak the language or be able to say something that works. After that, I took the train to Marrakesh and started my adventure. Yay.
She hid around corners and she hid under beds. She killed it with kisses and from it she fled. With every bubble she sighed.
This is the place where I stayed. It's called the Splash Riyadh. It is actually the king's personal physician's home, but the place where I was my wet water trip from rents it out. Here you see us walking through the Medina. There's all these tiny little alleyways and you really, really get lost. You see men wearing jabalas. You also see people begging, women wearing full-on clothing, some even wearing burqas. You can also buy things like oranges here, spices, and tea for mint, which is very, very delicious in Morocco. Welcome to the Marrakesh Meat Market. In the meat market, you can buy anything from goat's heads to chicken feet to, well, anything that's not pork at least. And what they have is they have everything just kind of hanging out there, and you just choose what you want, and they basically wrap it up for you. Seems to be a pretty decent system of buying food. These are Berber men. If you stop and try to take their picture, then they harass you for money, so I just took video. This is the silver market. Even though you can buy things that aren't silver here, this is where all of the craftsmen are, and these are where things like Moroccan lamps and all of the pretty artwork is really done. And if you want to get something that is unique and authentic to Morocco, this is where you would come and buy it. This is the Cascades Ouzoud, which basically means the Ouzoud waterfalls, where we stopped and had tagine for lunch. And also got to listen to some authentic Berber music. As you leave the Cascades Ouzoud, you realize that it's basically like a Moroccan family vacation spot, and there are tons and tons and tons of people selling what are, you know, souvenirs, pieces of cloth. Those are tagines there where you make food. You buy everything from little silver amulets to rugs for your house. This is the lake where we'll eventually end our rafting trip. We still have to drive all the way around these mountains to the other side in order to get where we'll put in at above 1,700 meters, or about 6,000 feet. This is where we set up our camp, outside of Ben Mellil in the Tlegyelet Center. Here, by the Professor Rock, we had a Berber camp. People here still live in mud brick houses and have thatched roofs. There's even small pensions or French hotels for people to stay at. Here you can see the snow blowing off the rock and the wind just picks up. Here's a marker that shows the beginning of the trail, and finally here are some pictures of our Berber camp. We had tents made of camel hair, and they fed us mint tea with yummy yummy olives for lunch and dessert. Here I am drinking some of the mint tea. I definitely recommend it, it's delicious. And this is where we slept and ate for the one night we spent in the Berber camp. This is them blowing up the tent for the next day. first 45 minutes of our trip were flat water, so we got to just basically practice paddling, look around and see all the monkeys in the trees, and basically just hang out. If you had to stretch, you had to stretch over the back of the boat in order to keep your back from cramping. Second night we camped on the river on a beach that we'd found. Basically put a tarp up, carried some wood, and then sat on a ledge while we watched the rain and ate food over a campfire. It's pretty awesome. The rafting was amazing. It was pretty much class 3 plus, class 4 all the way. But it was really, really technical. The water was low, so there were a lot of rocks, and we got hung up sometimes. Kind of funny seeing our guide cursing as we had to get out and push the raft off of the rocks. This stretch river is called the Gorge, and it's super narrow with lots of undercuts, so we'd be really, really careful not to lose anybody overboard to drown and die. After I arrived in Rome, I took a taxi to the Hotel Fontana, which is right outside the Trevi Fountain, and it was absolutely nuts because this was the 150th anniversary of the unification of Italy. So there were lots and lots of celebrations going on, and the president was actually out there signing all of the paperwork. I got to see the Spanish Steps, I got to walk around and see all of the different stalls, and then after that, I ate pizza and had gelato. It was delicious. But wait a minute, something's wrong. Hey mambo, mambo Italiano, hey mambo, mambo Italiano, go, go, go. You mixed up Siciliano, all you Calabrese do the mambo like a crazy with a hey mambo. Don't want a tarantella, eh mambo. No more the mozzarella, eh mambo. Mambo Italiano. In Rome, I took a 10-hour bike tour. I was the only person on the tour, so I basically got to follow along behind Emmanuel as we biked along the streets of Rome and saw, I would say, pretty much every single monument or column or ruin that exists. Since Rome has horrible traffic, we tried to bike along different routes and ended up biking among the people. You get a happy in the feet, so when you mumbo Italiano. Shake a baby, shake a cause of love when you take a me. I'ma say you stop or I'm gonna tell a papa and I hate ya drool. You don't have to go to school, just make a way to be the bambino. It's like a vino, kid, you're good at looking but you don't know it's cooking till you. Hey mambo, mambo Italiano. Hey mambo, mambo Italiano. Oh, oh, oh. You mixed up Siciliana, it's so delicious. Everybody come capisce how to mambo Italiano. It was an amazing trip, and 10 days and 11,000 miles later, I flew home.